Hello everybody, sorry so much for the delay in any content for the Range Rovers. Working on that workshop concrete slab, and then I'm trying to get our summer vehicle ready for vacation, and then we had some health issues and family stuff going on, but I won't bother you with all that boring stuff. Instead, I'll make a short video here about something that is actually related to the Range Rover. So, yay! To all my American viewers, happy Independence Day, have a nice one, spend it with family, and have fun. Sorry about my voice being so bad because I'm having a throat infection. But thank you very much for reaching 200 subscribers already. That's amazing. I didn't know that was that many Range Rover P38 fans out there that find this stuff useful. It's just overwhelming, and I've gotten so much good positive feedback and constructive feedback. I really, really appreciate it. I'm going to go back to some of the old videos, fix the audio stuff on them, the music tracks and all that stuff. I see and hear you guys. It's just that I have a bad connection to upload all the videos, but I'll re-upload all those soon. The old ones will be there still, but there'll be a link to new ones if you don't want the music and all that stuff. But thank you so much for all your feedback and comments. It really, really helps me. And I'm really sorry because of the delays in these videos. But today, I'm gonna show you guys how to fix one of the locks. This is from the glove box. I think the ignition key is pretty similar. The door locks should be similar in the design. That this is called a wafer lock. I've been cheating and looking at LockLab and Bosnianbill and LockPickingLawyer online on YouTube. Learned a lot of stuff from them. I had an issue when I replaced the glove box. I had to replace the button for the glove box because I broke the wire connection going to the release on the glove box. So that means I had to take out the whole lock, but stupid me, I followed the instructions in the workshop manual, got the lock out, and then I just pull out the keys, and all this happens if you do that. Everything just pops out, and there's a bunch of springs and everything, and these are all different, but they're numbered. Let's see if you can find that number. You can see if you can focus on it. Where is it? There you can see this is number 12. If you pick up another one, that's something different. This is number 22. So there's 8 of these called wafers and 8 springs. I only have 7 because I lost one, but I have a brand new one I'm gonna put in there. I just doesn't have it right here. This last one is just to keep the key into the lock when you open the locks, so you can pull out the key with the glove box in like halfway open or closed. So it just goes into this last big groove here near the key to hold the key in place. So I dropped all of this on the ground. I managed to pick up all the 7 springs and the 8 wafers. So just one of the springs, as I said. And there's no real easy way to figure out which way to put all this back together. There's no number on the key or anything. Nothing back here that tells you which way to put in the keys, this wafer in the lock. I guess you can call Land Rover, but I'm pretty sure they'd be hesitant to give out this information over the phone or through the counter, customer service, or at a dealer or anything. I'm pretty sure you would have to leave this stuff with them and then pay a whole lot of money to have them fix it. However, there's a pretty easy way to fix this yourself, so let me show you how I fixed this one. It took me about 10-15 minutes once I understood the logic behind it. I had to reshoot the whole video because I had to take off the audio cap so that you could hear any audio on the video. I'll call this the upside, where that the locking wafer goes in. And I'll start by drawing up a schematic of it. This will be the locking wafer. This will be the first, second, third, and fourth wafer. And when you turn it around, we'll do the same, 4, 3, 2, and 1 on the bottom side. These are numbered, so when I pull out, and all these wafers get pushed out by the springs, get everything out first. They are a little bit dirty, got some corroding here from watering grass, so I'll clean them off before I put them back in the car and make sure they're all good and moving smoothly. I'll see if I can get all my springs in one place. I'll put the springs a little bit to the side here. I'll start by arranging these by ascending number. Here's a 12, a 13, a 24. There'll be at least four different ones, because you'll be able to use the keys both ways in the lock. 22, another 22, another 13, a 14. Okay, so you have five different ones at least. 24 and we have that locking wafer. So 1, 2, 3, 4, there's five different wafer sizes there. And what happens when you put the key in, it goes into the wafer like this and follows the grooves on the key and moves up and down with the grooves on the key. My theory is that there's at least a pair on one side, each side of the key someplace. So we'll have three pairs and one probably that won't be a pair. But we'll see how that goes. It might not be quite true, but we'll find out. But that's my starting working theory. And what I do is, I take my cylinder and then insert a spring in the first slot. Excuse me for not using correct terminology if I'm misspelling or mispronouncing stuff. I always keep the numbers away from the lock. I'm not sure if that's the way it's supposed to be done, but I'm having the number facing away from the key towards the back of the lock. And here you can see it turned around and the spring fell out again, so I'll put the spring back in. So I'll start with the biggest number I have, 24, and put it in the first slot. I'll make sure it moves freely. Sorry if there's shadows here, but I don't have any good lighting in this room. Then I'll try and insert the key. I might need to help it a little bit to get in there, but we can see when the key is fully in, make sure it's fully in, it's too far down, so this would not be able to turn in the, it'll stop and not turn in the lock. It's probably supposed to be in one, at least not the last one, perhaps maybe the third one, because there you can see it fits pretty nicely. I'll try and get it out. It's a little bit tricky when you get the wrong wafer in the very wrong position. So you might have to push it up or pull it up a little bit to help it out. Don't force it so you don't break the wafers. Then I'll go to my next one, my 22. I'll just systematically try and decrease my number until I get something that seems to fit. Got lucky here, I guess. We seem to have something that fits pretty perfectly. So I'll write in a 22 in my top wafer spot. I'll take that one out, put it aside so I know I reserved it, not use it again. I'll move the spring over to the next slot. Then I'll start again. Try a 24 in the next slot. Might be that place that it fits. No, that doesn't look too good. It's protruding too far down. That won't work. So it's even further in someplace. I'll put it back in my unused stack of... And I'll move the spring over to my third slot. And then... What I'm saying... Sorry. I'll keep my spring in that one until I find the right wafer. We already used 22 in the first one. So I doubt there'll be a 22 there. I'm guessing there's going to be a 22 on the bottom. So I'm saving that for that one. So I'm jumping over to the next one, which is 14. I could write out here that I have two 24s. I had two 22s. There's one 14. Two 13s. And one 12. And then I'll try and insert the key again. That looks pretty good. It's protruding. I think that's too far down. I don't think that'll work. Even if there's some... could be some wear on the key. But I doubt that much. So I think 14 is not the right one either. So we'll try a 13. I think we're getting close. So I'm feeling good about the 13. Let's see, get it to move smoothly in the, there we go, that looks pretty good, might be a bit, just a tad bit there, but I think that's probably wear on the key, so I'm pretty sure that we have a 13 that fits in that second slot. I'll put that aside, take out the spring, move it to the third slot, start with my 24s. I'm not gonna try and use 13 or 22 because I know I have to use one of those on the bottom side. That looks darn good. I think that's where the 24 is supposed to be. So I put it in my diagram, pull out the key, put away the wafer, move my spring over to the fourth slot. So we used up 24, 22, 13, so we have 12 or 14 that's supposed to be in the last slot by elimination I'm pretty sure that we have to have the same wafers on the bottom side or else the key will only work one way. So even though I'm not a lock expert, I think that's the way it works. So let's try the 14 and see how that works. If I can pick it up, use my tweezers, I guess. I Set it in there. Make sure it moves freely. Insert the key. It's a little bit tricky because it's twisting a little bit. You can see here it's trying to move with the key. So I need to help it a little bit to keep it in place. But it seems to not be cooperating. Let me try and turn the key and see if it helps. I got the key in, but it seems to be sticking out too much. I don't think that's a 14. There you go, springs out. Make sure the spring is back in, so let's try the 12. Putting in the 12. And I'm putting that notch over the spring all the time. So that's what presses against the spring. Well, that looks pretty nice and smooth. Oops. I think we have a 12 that goes into that spot. So I think we have a combination that works on that side, but we have to check the other side to make sure that we haven't missed anything. So I'm turning it around, starting from number one. And if I'm numbering them wrong, then I'm sorry, but just my logic that closest to the key is one. So you lock experts might have a good laugh, but that's fine. I'm an amateur. We had a 22 on top, so let me try the same combination on the bottom. That's my theory, that it's matching up and down. Sorry, I keep dropping these wafers all the time. There, and try and insert the key. That looks pretty good. Both sides flush. Key moves fine. So I think 22 is the correct one there. Getting the spring out. Moving it to the next slot. We had a 13 there, so let's try 13 on the same side here and see if it works. Make sure it moves freely. Like I said, I need to clean this. It's protruding a little bit, but I think that could be keyware. Let me try and flip the key and see what happens. I think that could work. I think so. Let's try it at least. Oh, it's stuck in there a little bit. Let me try and... There we go. I think we have a 13, so I'll put it down there. 24 was the next one we had. Let me move the spring first. Spring over into the third slot. Try and put in the 24 wafer like we had on top. Insert the key. Key moves smoothly. It seems it protrudes a little bit, but I think that's just acceptable tolerance from manufacturing of these locks. Looks pretty good. But I'm not 100% sure, so I'm doing that. Then we have the last one. Moving the spring over to the fourth. And then we have only the 14 left. You can see we had a 12 on top, so we should have 12 there too. But I think the reason is that these... that there's 112 and 114 is that you have a valet key that only operates the doors and ignition lock and not the glove box. So that's probably the reason that there's not a complete match on both sides. So the key is probably a little bit different on the valet key. So let's try and insert the 14 here and see what happens, if it works. That doesn't look good at all. Nope, that's not where it's supposed to be. So we know we have to try and rearrange something here probably. Let's try and put it up here where the 13 was in the second row. See if it works better there. That's not too bad. Not too bad. So it could be 14 there. Let's see if 13 fits in place of 14 in the back here then. So let's see if we have 13. There we have 13. Yeah, that's not too bad. Not too bad at all. Maybe a little bit too much out there. Let me for fun try 24 over there, even though I'm pretty sure 24 is supposed to be in the third one and not the fourth one. Let me just try it for fun. I think that was actually a much better fit. That looks extremely flush. I'm gonna say 24 is supposed to be there. And then probably 13 is gonna be in the third one. I hope so. Let's try and do that at least. I'll move over to the third one and put the 13 in there and see if it works. It's just twisting a little bit, so let me just try and hold it in place so I can get the key. You can see it's trying to twist with the moving of the key. It's just being a little bit stubborn with me. Doesn't seem like it wants to, doesn't want to be in this spot. Which I guess is okay. If it doesn't fit, it doesn't fit. Let me just check that it's not dirty or anything. There we go, it was just... No, it protrudes a little bit too much, so... So that's not the right one there. And 14 didn't want to be there either, I'm sure. Let's see... Well, 14 looks pretty... Pretty nice. Let me just double check that it is 14. That's a 14, yeah. Maybe 14 is supposed to be there instead. Let's try 13 in slot number 2 then. Which should match with 13 on the top row. Let's see. That moves very smoothly, and it's just a tad bit up, but that's, I think we had the same issue with 13 there too, so that's probably just wear on the key. So, I think we have a solution that looks like this. So what I'm going to do now is put in all the wafers. First I'll fill up all the springs here. Try and just get one spring in each opening. Three. My tweezer was magnetic, so it was a little bit difficult to use. So I'll start filling up from the back there with number 12 first. 12 in the back. 24. You can buy new wafers and rekey your locks. That's probably very helpful if you have to replace a door or ignition lock and don't want to be hassled with having two different keys to operate the car, one for the door and one for the ignition. And then 13 and then 22 in the front. So you can use this method to rekey a new lock if you have to get a new lock to work with your old key. Just take the wafers out and note the placement of them in the old cylinder and put them in the new cylinder, or buy new wafers with the correct numbers that match the old ones and put that in the new cylinder. Now I'm trying to hold in all this while I turn it around so they don't spring out. I'm trying to put in the springs without losing anything on the back side. Trying to keep it in camera as well. My camera turns off the display after a while, so I'm hoping everything is in display. Let me just double check. I hope I haven't been too far up. There, and the next one is supposed to be the 14. Goes there, and then it was the 13. Goes there. Numbers towards the back, away from the key. And then the 22 in the front, that won't have a spring, so it will just fall in there. I'll hold over all of this. And I'll put in this key retainer in the front. It just holds the key into the lock. Let me just try and put it in first, I'll show you. So I'm trying to lightly just release my pressure on this. I can put in the key. It's a little bit difficult to film. But there we go, the key went in. Looks pretty darn good flush on both sides. I'm supposed to be a spring on this one too, I think. What this is supposed to be doing is keeping the key in place so you can't pull out the key once that tab is down. And that's when the lock is partially open or partially closed, so you don't pull out the key in between locked and unlocked. So there you go. That's how you key or fix your lock if you drop everything out. And you can use the same procedure to re-key your key if you buy a new one. Taking out the glovebox key is pretty easy, so you could do that and then disassemble to build this map of what wafers you need. So in case you need to rekey your car for ignition or later, you have this template laying around. I'll just show you a little trick that I found to so I can remove the key. I want to dry my car a little bit later. I'll tape over the wafers, but leave room for them to move a little bit so you can move the key out in and out, but not too much so that they spring out. So I leave a little bit room there in the tape for them to move around. And the same here on the other side. That way I can remove the key and not drop anything. I hope you found this useful and helpful. And if you do, consider subscribing. Leave some comments below if you have any questions. Give it a thumbs up if you like it. If you already subscribed, then thank you very much for doing so. It really, really helps me. Take care, and until next time, have fun and keep wrenching.